Okay, everyone, welcome. Thank you for coming back on time, and welcome to this, the first panel of the day, the private life, individual privacy, self and subject. We've got three speakers from different backgrounds to share their reflections with us. First up is Professor David Feldman, who is the Rouse Ball Professor of English Law here at Cambridge, the author of several books on British law. He's also an honorary bencher at Lincoln's Inn in London and an academic associate of 39 Essex Chambers, as well as being a fellow of the British Academy. His paper this morning is entitled One Lawyer's View of Private Life. Thank you. Sorry, one procedural point. We'll just go through the three papers and then have a panel discussion at the end, so save up your questions.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be invited to participate. I must start by apologising for the fact that my participation is fleeting because of other commitments in different parts of Cambridge. I'm just sort of flying in for this, and then I'm going to have to slip away quickly after the session, so apologies. But you'll probably find you're glad to see the back of me. The title of the session, Private Life, Individual Privacy, Self and Subject, is of course a tricky one. One of the most controversial issues in this subject area is whether we should talk about privacy or privacy. I firmly nail my colours to the privacy mast, so that gives you all you need to know about my philosophical position. I'm a lawyer, and inevitably we approach these issues to some extent from within, as John said at break time, from our own disciplinary silos. So I don't know how many lawyers do we have here? One, two, three, a few lawyers. Okay. In that case, while I explain my disciplinary silo, you can go to sleep, and then I'll wake you up again when I've got onto something interesting. I think it's really important if we're going to think about taking privacy and converting it into a form in which it can be given legal effect, to understand not just what we mean by privacy, and of course we all mean different things, come on to that in a couple of minutes, but also what is involved in giving something legal effect. And I want to make three initial points about this. The first is that the word privacy and related terms like private life and the phrase I particularly like to use, which is privacy-related rights, because I don't actually believe in privacy. This is when people get out the tomatoes. If they're going to be used as a basis for some form of legal regulation, they need to be put into a legal form. And what lawyers need in order to make privacy work from a legal perspective is rather different from what philosophers or engineers or sociologists and so on need. Specifically, the methodology of law when it comes to big concepts like privacy, the methodology of law is what Gunther Teubner called autopoietic. Law doesn't invent these concepts for itself. It borrows, it imports from other areas of intellectual activity and social activity and political thought. And we take these, but then we have to adapt them into a shape which makes it possible to use them for legal purposes. And by doing that, by importing but then adapting for legal purposes, we have to do certain things which non-lawyers don't have to do. The first of them is we have to think about how this can be workable from a distinctively legal perspective. Now, what is a distinctively legal perspective? Here I'm going to oversimplify hugely and say that law as an activity is concerned with the use of coercion. It's the coercive application of state force or the threat of state force for particular purposes. If we want to operate under conditions where the application of state force through law is contained in a particularly procedurally appropriate way, then we have to think about what's sometimes called the rule of law. And for me, in this context anyway, the rule of law requires that the notions that we're using, the triggers for the application of state force, are capable of being articulated with reasonable clarity, so we can say in advance in what circumstances they will be applied. Secondly, we need to be able to contain them in rules of more or less general application. We can't say, oh, well, we'll make up our minds on a case-by-case basis, see what looks good at the time, because that's the negation of law rather than the means of developing law. And thirdly, we need to think about obligations, because coercive force is justifiably applied, in my view, only to give effect to legitimate obligations. So people have rights to privacy. If you want to talk about a right to privacy, I don't, but some people do. If you want to talk about a right to privacy, you have a right to privacy, in my view, only so far as there is a set of obligations which can be defined and articulated reasonably clearly. And you have the right so far as the obligations are, first of all, applicable to particular people or institutions. For example, you may say that a right to privacy should be enforceable against everybody, or you might say it should be enforceable against the state only, or you might say it should be enforceable never against the state and only against ordinary people. Those are all perfectly legitimate ways of approaching the question of the incidence or applicability of legal rights and obligations. Then there's a separate question that arises, which is of enforceability. It does not follow that because something is encapsulated in a legal norm, it should be enforceable. And if it is to be enforceable, if it's to be more than simply a sort of rhetorical flourish or an expression, wouldn't this be a nice thing to do? Wouldn't it be nice if we could all get along together nicely? If you're going to have some sort of last resort enforcement, you have to decide who is going to enforce it. Is it going to be self-help? You know, in the law of trespass, for example, if someone trespasses on our land, we're entitled to use reasonable force to remove them if they don't go when told. Should this be the primary means of enforcement of privacy rights? Or should there be a privacy regulator, a special enforcement agency? Or should we say it's not going to be done by human agency at all? It's going to be done through engineering or computerized algorithms in some way? Or should we say that there'll be a judicial role? And if so, what should the judicial role be? What remedies should be available? So all of those things have to be contained in a legal rule if it's going in any useful way to protect privacy. And those are requirements which don't generally apply outside the realms of legal rights and legal enforcement. Of course, the norms themselves have to be articulated and promulgated in such a way as to make it possible for all those different forms, or whichever forms of instance or enforcement you want, can work. And all those require decisions that are at root political. It's a political decision, the circumstances in which state force can coercively be applied. It's a political decision about the mode of enforcement. It's also a political decision as to the position of any applicable general privacy norm or norms within the hierarchy of norms of the international legal, municipal constitutional, municipal legal order, or orders, depending on the view your particular order takes of the relationship between itself and other orders. And those are political questions. Now, I could give examples, but I shall press on for the moment. That's my first point. Second point, within the legal community as outside it, there is going to be significant difference of opinion as to what the core meaning or meanings of privacy is or are. Law is no different in that regard from any other system, and the boundaries of privacy and privacy obligations are likely to be contested through the legal system as well as through the political system during the period in which the various political questions I outlined a second ago are being debated. And no solution that's reached is permanent. Anything can be revisited. So there will be, and this is, in my view, one of the essential features of law, is that it's a field of continuous contestation in relation to all the matters that I mentioned in respect of the first of them. Law typically doesn't give you answers, it gives you ways of trying to find answers, but they have to be practical answers to practical questions. And that's a distinctive feature of the legal contribution to privacy. Third point. Every system is going to reach a different set of solutions. Because in each system, there'll be a different set of constitutional, political, philosophical, social assumptions which go into the process of reaching political answers to all the questions I mentioned earlier. So, privacy is inevitably, as a legal concept, highly culturally specific. Now, what's the implication of that? The implication is that there isn't an idea of privacy and there isn't a way of protecting it. There are many, many ideas of privacy. At about 20 years ago, 22, 23 years ago, I came to the conclusion it wasn't worth trying to work out what privacy was. And so I moved away from that and started to think in terms of privacy-related rights. And about 19 years ago, I thought, well, privacy-related rights are fine, but how do we decide on the boundaries of privacy-related rights for legal purposes, given the particular feature that in law we're concerned with coercive threats? And my suggestion, and I will just throw this at you and then sit down, my suggestion is that privacy-related rights are many and various because the obligations that support different aspects and different conceptions of privacy are many and different. But in order, I suggested, to be particularly weighty, to form a politically justifiable reason for threatening or using the coercive power of the state in order to protect privacy interests, it's important not to have a conception of legal privacy, or perhaps I should say a legal conception of privacy, which is individualistic and excludes the interests of the community. So my view of privacy-related rights are those rights which, and associated obligations, which protect areas of, or spaces of, physical space, time, activity, and so on, so far as is necessary to create the conditions for people to contribute in a positive way to useful social activity. We all form part of social circles, and we, to some extent, define our identity by reference to the social circles of which we form part. The important part of privacy for me, the part of privacy which justify the threat of coercive state force in order to protect that form of privacy, the important part of privacy is that which protects those relationships and our ability to enter into those relationships which we need in order to be useful members of society, or at least useful members of the social circles, whether it's family, friends, work, business, government, in which we operate. And it follows, therefore, also, this comes back to a point that I had debated on some rather tedious television programs over the weekend. It follows also that whether or not you say that public figures have a right to privacy, they won't have the same right to privacy as people who aren't. Thank you.
Thank you, David Feldman. So our next speaker is Barbara Taylor, who is Professor of History and English at Queen Mary University of London and co-director of the Raphael Samuel History Centre. Her path-breaking book, Eve in the New Jerusalem, Socialism and Feminism in the 19th Century, won the Isaac Deutscher Memorial Prize. And she's since written widely on history, as well as different forms of memoir, including her own. Barbara's current research project is on a history of solitude during the Enlightenment. Her paper this morning is entitled, Why Not Solitude?
Thank you, Daniel, and thank you for the invitation to speak at this event. Thank you to all the organizers, to CRASSH. I'm coming at it from a slightly sideways or backwards or something position, so I'm not entirely sure how much what I'm going to have to say is of relevance to our discussions today, but I hope it has some interest of its own on its own, and I guess I'll sort of see about that. I'm currently, as Daniel indicated, my current writing project is a sort of intellectual history of solitude in Enlightenment Britain, and this is an enormous topic, very unwieldy, and I'm still at a fairly early stage, so some of what I'm saying is sort of selective and speculative. Solitude, just to kick off, is of course not the same as privacy. I'll probably alternate between the two. It's only in relatively recent times, that is from a historian's point of view, sort of the last four centuries or so, that the concepts have become closely linked. In his excellent book, Josh Cohen, who's going to be speaking after me, uses these terms, solitude and privacy, pretty much interchangeably, especially when referring to subjective privacy, that inner region of the self, veiled, unspoken, unspeakable, that point within our souls where all stands single, far hidden from the reach of words, to quote William Wordsworth, which Josh calls the private self and Wordsworth called solitude. I say subjective privacy because, of course, the private sphere includes much which is social. Private businesses, communications, the family, sexual relationships. In most modern societies, solitude, in the sense of complete aloneness, is regarded as requisite only for a very small number of private activities, defecation, autoeroticism, book writing. And our inter... I'm not commenting on the... Our internet age may be turning some of these private activities, autoeroticism, for example, into social activities. In fact, some people think that solitude is disappearing, especially among the young. The American cultural pundit William Dershowitz, in a very interesting essay entitled The End of Solitude, tells the story of a teenager who sends something in the region of 3,000 texts every month. And he calculates that's 100 a day, one every 10 waking minutes, morning, noon, and night, weekdays, weekends, class time, lunchtime, homework time, and toothbrushing time. So on average, she's never alone for more than 10 minutes at once, which means she's never alone. David Anderson, QC, in his report we read for today, cites an Observer article bemoaning the death of privacy, while Josh's book describes a modern war on privacy. And in his book, Josh quotes the News of the World reporter Paul McMullen, who was an inveterate phone hacker, who, and he was testifying to the Leveson inquiry into phone hacking, declared that in 21 years of invading people's privacy, I've never actually come across anyone who's been doing any good. Privacy is for pedos. It's evil. It brings out the worst qualities in people. Privacy is the space bad people need to do bad things in. So privacy today is under fire. The right to be alone, invoked by David Anderson in his report, is hotly contested. But how new is this dissension? In fact, if we substitute solitude for privacy in the quote from Paul McMullen that I've just read, we find that the hostility expressed there by this unrepentant phone hacker has a long, very long, and respectable pedigree, stretching back to the ancients, and then traceable across the centuries until it reaches an apparent high point in the period that I'm studying. Right-thinking people in the 18th century, by and large, set their faces against solitude, and this is what I'm going to talk about briefly today. Researching the history of solitude is, as I've been discovering, challenging. Of all the human universals, solitude is probably the least examined, the least historicized. Birth, death, desire, pain, all these have substantial historiographies, but not solitude. Why? Well, Nietzsche may give us part of the answer. Oh, he exclaimed in 1881 in Daybreak, if only there were someone who could tell us the history of that subtle feeling called solitude. Solitude is subtle, intangible. It escapes easy definition. Like all psychological states, it needs to be conceptualized before it can be historically analyzed. What is this subtle feeling, if indeed it is a feeling, that we call solitude? The common sense reply, an emotional response to being without other people, clearly won't do, since being with others is for many people the most solitary condition of all. Isolation, seclusion, privacy, none of these are solitude, although some may be preconditions for it. Sometimes aloneness is lonely, for some people unbearably lonely. Solitude, John Donne wrote, after a period of confinement with illness, is a torment which is not threatened in hell itself. For other people, especially but not exclusively religious solitaries, solitude is a privileged site of intimate connection, an always accompanied condition. Never less alone than when alone. Nothing so companionable as solitude. Alone in a crowd, solitude is best society. The famous epigrams say it all. The language of solitude is crammed with such paradoxes. For little do men perceive what solitude is and how far it extendeth, Francis Bacon opined in 1625, at the point when solitude was first coming into general usage in English and French. For Bacon, solitude was lovelessness. Quote, for a crowd is not company, and faces are but a gallery of pictures, and talk but a tinkling cymbal where there is no love. Unquote. To be without true friends, Bacon went on, was a mere and miserable solitude. And anyone choosing such a way of life, such as the ancient hermits, could not be fully human. Whatsoever is delighted in solitude, Bacon averred, quoting Aristotle, is either a wild beast or a god. Writing at the dawn of the modern age, Bacon invokes the classical view of human nature as essentially social. No man can suffice unto himself, only a god. And the solitudes of beasts I'll return to in a minute. The reference to ancient hermits reminds us that in post-Reformation Britain, solitude was strongly associated with Catholicism. It also highlights the special opprobrium directed at what early modern writers dubbed absolute solitude, as opposed to other varieties of solitude, which by our modern standards appear to varying degrees more social than solitary. Let me clarify this. Solitude in the 17th century and for most of the 18th century meant withdrawal from one type of social setting, a city, a court, a cathedral, to another, a country house, a monastery, a closet meaning a private room for prayer or study, in a family home. These solitudes could be controversial. Scholars who sequestered themselves in their closets were accused of abandoning their friends, while country house retirees, surrounded by family, friends, and servants, were sometimes charged with selfish neglect of social duties. But it was absolute or total solitude that was the principal focus of criticism and concern. To voluntarily seek out such solitude was unnatural, egoistical, and debilitating. Even religious recluses were not exempt from such criticism, while ordinary mortals who preferred solitude to sociability were roundly condemned. In solitude, men's vices find them out and attack them, the diarist John Evelyn polemicized in 1667 in a pamphlet debate over solitude in which his opponent, the Scottish jurist George Mackenzie, defended the solitary life, insisting that nature, inclination, and pleasure vote all for solitude. Evelyn was having none of this. Quote, he ought to be a wise and good man indeed that dares trust himself alone, for ambition and malice, lust and superstition are in solitude as in their kingdom. Solitude bred misanthropy and melancholy. It made people vulnerable to diabolic influence and gave license to secret thoughts and behaviors, especially erotic thoughts and behaviors. Most injurious of all, perhaps, it unleashed the imagination, that wildly inventive element in the human psyche. The critics didn't have it all their way, however. If a preference for solitude was invariably reprehensible in the common man, a thing of the belly and the passions, to quote Seneca, for individuals of a higher order, it brought many advantages. A direct engagement with the source of knowledge, divine or natural, intimate communion with God, or his 18th century equivalent, nature, contemplative interludes from the active life, self-cultivation and moral introspection, purification from worldly corruptions, to list but a few. 18th century retirement poets hymned the blameless pleasures of solitary life on a rural estate, far from the vices of the city. But these benefits accrued only to those with sufficient moral stamina to see off solitude's perils. An ethical elite whose membership altered over the centuries, which remained, as you might guess, almost entirely male. And as I've indicated, a life lived entirely solo was always blameworthy. Hence Daniel Defoe's concern to remind his readers that Robinson Crusoe's desert island solitude was imposed, not chosen, and to assure them that the religious revelations Crusoe experienced during his years on the island were no argument for a life alone. True solitude, in contrast to monkish solitude, as Defoe and many others Protestant intellectuals labeled it, was an inner retreat, a retirement into the soul that was possible anywhere, even, Defoe insisted, in the middle of the stock exchange. By contrast, a wholly sequestered life was unchristian, a very mean thing, a rape upon human nature. Crusoe's island solitude has been read as a cautionary tale of capitalist alienation, a monitory image of the ultimate consequences of absolute individualism, as Ian Watt put it in his classic interpretation of the novel. And this brings me to what I take to be one of the themes of today, which is the relationship between the private self, or the solitary self as I'm describing it, and Western modernity. Have people become more private, more solitary, since the rise of what 18th century intellectuals described as commercial society or civilization, which was a word coined by Enlightenment modernists in the mid-18th century? I don't have the answer to this question. What I can tell you is that the now familiar critique of capitalism that associates it with solitude, with atomization, isolation, alienation, anomie, played almost no part in 18th century British writings, in which solitariness was almost invariably described as a primitive condition, savage, animalistic, or at the very least, pre-modern, uncivilized. I think I'm going to skip this next paragraph, which is about savagery and solitude. If anyone's interested, they can ask me. However, there was one feature of 18th century modernity, which was strongly associated with solitude. Alongside its identification with the wild and the primitive, which is what I've just skipped telling you about, solitude was also associated with the anonymity of urban life. A connection which, as David Vincent suggests in his excellent book, began with the growth of cities in the 16th and 17th centuries. A great city is a great solitude, Francis Bacon wrote in a much quoted adage, which he describes as Latin, Latinate, and I have searched, if anyone can find the source for this in classical philosophy, I would be very grateful for it. I think he coins it himself, but at any rate, he says, so a great city is a great solitude because in a great town, friends are scattered, so that there is not that fellowship, for the most part, which is in less neighborhoods. In place of true friends, then, one had only the mob, the human horde pressing in on the self, forcing it back into the self. Some people saw real advantages to this. In 1628, René Descartes, citing his lack of privacy in Paris, took himself off to Amsterdam, where, quote, amidst this great mass of busy people, I have been able to lead a life as solitary and withdrawn as if I were in the most remote desert. Likewise, Joseph Addison, editor of the hugely influential periodical, The Spectator, who in 1711 chose to retire into the solitude, these are his words, of London, from the countryside to lose himself amid the crowd and thus avoid the intrusiveness of rural community life. Again, as with all forms of solitude, this choice was acceptable for upright men, civilized individuals of good moral habits. For lesser beings, however, notably women and the young, cities enhance solitude's dangers, especially sexual, stimulating the imagination and providing ideal conditions for the exercise of secret vices, especially sexual vices. Jean-Jacques Rousseau's fictional pupil, Émile, in the 1762 didactic novel of that name, is kept well away from Paris during his youth. When he finally ends up there, in a sequel to the novel, he soon becomes entangled in adultery and related miseries. Rousseau's other fictional hero, the young tutor Saint-Preux, from his 1761 romantic novel, La Nouvelle Louise, experiences Paris as a vast desert, a frightful solitude in which a dismal silence reigns. For Saint-Preux, a man like his creator, addicted to personal sincerity and transparency, Paris is a scene of terrible inauthenticity, a place of many masks, where he finds only a vain semblance of feelings and of truth. My soul in the crowd attempts to pour itself out, but everywhere finds itself closed in. I am never less alone than when I am alone, said an ancient author. For my part, I am only alone in the crowd, where my heart would like to speak, but it feels it is not being listened to at all. The urban solitude of Émile and Saint-Preux prefigures the alienation of city life as portrayed by 19th and 20th century writers and artists. As in previous centuries, well-to-do individuals in these later times turned to the countryside, as had Rousseau back in the 1750s, as an escape from urban anomie. Rural retreats continued to offer solitude of a sociable register. However, the mention of Rousseau directs our attention to a very different kind of solitude. Solitude as the epicenter of a singular private self, a self whose authenticity and moral freedom is founded not in sociality, but in mental life, in the secret inner world of the individual, and in particular in the imagination, in all its chaotic tropical luxuriance, to quote David Anderson again. Here is Nietzsche's subtle solitude in its first incarnation. If there is such a thing as a distinctively modern self, then Rousseau's famous portrayals of his solitary imaginings in his Reveries of a Solitary Walker, Confessions and Elsewhere, surely helped to create it. Yet even in Rousseau's writings, the dangers of solitude loom large, especially in his political texts, where solitude is depicted as the enemy of a well-ordered state. To make a stable and peaceful polity, Rousseau counseled, one must strip all its members of any private sense of self. From childhood onward, people must be forced to forego their individuality in favor of the common life. A true citizen is one who, when he is alone, is nothing. That's Rousseau. A meal is never left alone or unwatched, even when he is asleep. Never let children play by themselves, Rousseau advised, but all together and in public, so that there is always a common goal to which all aspire. So the surveillance culture isn't new to us. Like privacy today, the solitary self has always had its enemies. What is different now, perhaps, is that this enmity has become so built into our culture that we do not even recognize it. The digitally joined up self has become our modern subjectivity. Or has it? And I was going to leave you with that question, but I'm going to take the advantage of being up here in front of you to just raise a slightly different question, which is from some recent experience of my own. I'm just going back to Saint Preux here, where he says, you know, his soul attempts to pour itself out. My heart would like to speak, but it feels it's not being listened to. Because the question I didn't have a chance to ask Christina was about what we might call the imposition of privacy on people. And this is a delicate and question, which is, what is it that our society forces into the arena of secrecy, of silence? And how is it that these taboos, people feel the difficulty of breaking them, the sense of whether or not they're going to be listened to, taken seriously, and so on. And then when people do, so obviously what I'm thinking of are issues around sexual abuse, questions of mental health, and so on. And where the expectation that people will keep things private can actually mean suppression of, so the heart wants to speak, but it feels it won't be listened to, or it's going to be listened to in the wrong sort of way. And I had quite a lot of direct experience of this recently, because I published a memoir about my own mental health history, and which was very well and generously received and got a lot of attention. But one of the things that people said to me constantly was, how is it that you have made public that which we would expect you to want to keep private? It was extremely self-revealing. And the answer, of course, was that I had chosen that which I would make public. And I have to tell you, I just want to say, because I think this is a little encouraging note about human nature. I have spoken to thousands of people. I did a count, I wrote thousands of people about my book, and only twice in all that time, and never in a public setting, have I been asked a question which I felt intruded on my privacy, despite the vulnerability that I offered to people. So it seems to me that there is the psychology of what constitutes privacy, what constitutes secrecy, and how in an age when people are finally being able to speak out about things, you know, how do we then find new ways ourselves of negotiating those boundaries? Seems to me to be more than just the right to be private. It has to also to be the right to be public, but to be heard with respect And that seems to me to raise another set of questions. So thank you very much.
Barbara. So next we have Josh Cohen, Professor of Modern Literary Theory at Goldsmiths, University of London, as well as being a psychoanalyst in private practice. He's the author of many books and articles on psychology, literature, and critical theory, from Herman Melville to Big Brother, the latter of which is addressed in his most recent book, The Private Life, Why We Remain in the Dark, published by Granta. His paper this morning is entitled The Privacy of the Self in an Age of Exposure.
Thank you, everyone. It's wonderful to, as Christina said in her introduction, to be addressing these issues in such a fascinatingly interdisciplinary context. I think what one has to say kind of resonates differently when people are coming at it from so many different directions. What I think there probably is consensus about would be the question of what brings this symposium into being, the context for its being a relevant topic for the moment, which would, of course, relate to the many ways in which controversies and anxieties, public anxieties around privacy. I'm very schizoid about privacy and privacy, I have to say, although I thought it was interesting that the professor of English law chose privacy and the North American academic chose privacy. says something about globalization, yeah. I don't know if it's Freudian. Over the last 6 years or so, in this country, scandals around media intrusion have proliferated, culminating in the protracted Leveson inquiry into the culture, conduct, and ethics of the British press. More recently, and especially since the Snowden revelations, these anxieties have run alongside the increasingly fierce debate over the scope and state of state and corporate intrusion and control over our private data. These contemporary controversies, of course, belong to the broader context of learning to manage and regulate a digital culture, which in so many ways threatens our existing conceptions of private and public. Much of the debate and commentary on privacy issues in recent years has rightly been focused on these phenomena and the legal, political, and technological dilemmas that they raise. But framing the debate in terms of the way state and non-state agencies are menacing our privacy rights risks simplifying our complex and ambiguous relationship to our privacy. To portray the private self today merely as the victim of malign external forces is to ignore the many daily ways in which we collude in the erosion of our own privacy. Only if we attend to how intricately the technological and political are bound up with the psychic and cultural dimensions of private life can we discern how we're at once victims and perpetrators of its erosion. This ambiguity might shed some light on how muted and uncertain public understanding of and protest against state and corporate surveillance has been. These offences against privacy are all too continuous with an intrusive culture that we have come to live and breathe. So there is the lack, I think, of a broader culture in which privacy would be understood as a right and indeed a pleasure worth having. Perhaps it's hard to generate real outrage then against a phenomenon with which we have become so complicit. It can feel as though we're being swept along by a drive towards total and permanent visibility, closing down the spaces in which a private self can preserve and cultivate itself. Just thinking about Barbara's triad of activities that would belong to the solitary sphere. There was autoeroticism, which she already acknowledged, of course, was now very easily and indeed is made public. There was book writing, and I was thinking about partly because my novelist namesake on the other side of the pond, Josh Cohen, actually recently wrote a novel online in 24 hours. And as to the third of the triad, I'm sure that's there if you're interested. I haven't checked myself. So an imperative no less powerful for being tacit coaxes us into dragging every region of ourselves, the selves of others as well as my own, into the light. And of course, Barbara warned me just before we came in, which was kind of a little bit sly, that she would want to go first because she was bringing up this quote before I could. That's all right. It's all forgivable. But privacy is for pedos. This, I suppose, is the exemplary mantra of this drive to bring the privacy of myself and the other into the light. Fundamentally, McMullen elaborated, no one else, that is no one other than bad people, need it. Privacy is evil. It brings out hypocrisy. Now, if we're to confront the contemporary crisis of privacy head on, we may just need to recognize how much, for all its pantomimic villainy, which McMullen does very well, I think, in his media appearances, how much it runs with rather than against the grain of our culture. And of course, this position, I think Barbara's point is extremely well taken, that there is a very strong intellectual lineage for this position, that it's not a kind of a pantomime villain position plucked out of the air. The avid consumption of and demand for the perpetual drip feed of reality TV, celebrity gossip, and the more ordinary forms of continuous self-revelation on social media hints at how privacy, the existence of a region of life withdrawn from the public gaze, has precisely become an evil, an obstacle in the way of our right to know whatever we want about whoever we want. Nowhere is this tacit conviction played out more than in our relationship with celebrities. By intruding into their bedrooms or their bodies or their bank accounts, the media and its consumers, that is more or less all of us, seek to penetrate and corrode not simply the privacy of a select few, but I think at a more cultural and symbolic level, privacy itself. The very existence, the conviction, the sense of privilege in relation to the celebrity's private life, I think expresses the sense that the very existence of a life unseen is a scandal that needs to be eliminated at all costs. In our frenzied peeping into the lives of others, then, we play out the belief that with a sufficient glut of light, nothing will remain unknown to us. And I'm sort of aware of the questions that were set up in the letter to contributors to this conference. We were invited to speak to a number of questions. I suppose all of us are speaking implicitly to all the questions that were raised. But there was one. The first question was, what is the relationship of privacy to anonymity? And I was thinking about this as I was making this point about the right to know everything, because I think of this assumed right as part of an attack on privacy, as an attack on the anonymous dimension of the self, in the sense of the self that doesn't want to be known, that conceals itself. If we're going to talk about lineages, writers have been particularly sensitive and attuned to this dimension of the self. And anonymity is, of course, a famous sort of way of framing stories. If one thinks of the way that many great works of literature are framed, instead of coming directly from the actual or assumed author or narrator of the novel, for example, or the philosophical work, instead it is framed as a story that has been found in a drawer. For example, Kierkegaard's Either Or is a selection of papers that has been found in a drawer by the author. Cervantes, Poe, Nabokov all play on the idea of a storytelling self that is at once confidential and intimate, but at the same time removed from themselves, anonymous. So psychoanalysis hints that this war on the unknown in the other might be a displaced rage against the unknown in myself. It intimates depths and excesses in us of love and hate, vulnerability and rage, fear and voraciousness we neither can nor want to know about. It insists that my inner life always exceeds any known quantity, and that this unknowability is a fundamental human predicament, a truth of every time and place. But different histories and cultures will bear the burden of this truth very differently. Our own culture of tacitly coerced self-externalization demands that we view ourselves as reducible to our external manifestations, to the pictures we can take of ourselves, the data we can share about ourselves. We are reducible, in short, to the self we can put on display. Social media facilitates the sharing of our deepest personal intimacies from birth to sex to grief. We're enjoined to create and broadcast life logs, rolling updates of some or even all of our lives. Far more than one of many arbitrary diversions in contemporary life, the life log is the purest distillation of the relationship we're forging with our own privacy. Under the name quantified self, life logging is taking on the dimensions of a distinct tendency and philosophy of our moment. Its basic premise is that we can employ a limitless array of technologies scaled to the minute dimensions of our everyday lives to resolve the essential problems of selfhood, bodily and mental. Wearable wristbands or smartphone apps measure, monitor and share the data of our daily bodily and neurochemical lives, cholesterol, mood swings, no doubt, soon enough, if not already, our serotonin and dopamine levels, as though the self were reducible to this sum of numbers. Some loggers use wearable cameras to record and instantly upload to the web every detail of their everyday lives. Such experiments in radical transparency show up a zeal to dispose of any excess or remainder in the self, to perceive ourselves as indifferent instances of a generalized calculus. So from my specific perspective, thinking about the second question addressed to us, the harm of a privacy infringement and how is it best articulated, I would tend to frame the harm of a privacy infringement, at least in part, in terms of the impoverishment of the possibilities of selfhood in the name of this quantification, this reduction to a generalized calculus. But this is to assume, along the lines of the chillingly resonant tech executives at the center of the circle, I agree with John's characterization of the novel in his opening address, that it's not a very good novel, but it is a fantastically kind of useful one. So this is to assume that along the lines of the circle's basic premise, that privacy can simply be abolished by a glut of transparency. And this is where I sort of, I suppose, would introduce a sort of subtle difference between myself and the sort of doom-mongering line of privacy is dead. My understanding of selfhood from as a psychoanalyst would suggest otherwise, in the sense that the private self cannot be reduced to the circumscribed spaces that we typically speak of as private, the home or the bank account or the hard drive, the external tokens of privacy, the privacy of what I do or own, although, of course, these are incredibly important and bound up with internal privacy. We don't, after all, cease to be private when we leave these private spaces and enter the public realm. Not even, in fact, when we broadcast our every waking moment to the world. So this is one of the ways that I really want to put in question the distinction between private and public. The private self isn't some discrete entity that we can simply leave behind. It is a perpetual presence. It is concealed and it is revealed in the minutest aspects of our everyday being. I like as a kind of encapsulation of this thought, Auden's famous quote in his dedication to a volume of Stephen Spender's, private faces in public places are wiser and nicer than public faces in private spaces. The private self then is revealed in the minutest aspects of our being, walking, smiling, speaking, writing, joking, eating, weeping, listening. Our private self is diffused in all the different ways we express it, so it isn't reducible to any of them. It's concealed not so much behind us as in us. And I draw on this for this conception of privacy a lot on the work of the American-born British psychoanalyst, Christopher Bolas, who talks about the private idiom. I see the two worlds that I occupy, the literary and the psychoanalytic, as intrinsically at odds with the imperative of permanent visibility that I find increasingly governing our culture. Not, of course, and again, Barbara's talk is salutary on this point, not that this imperative is simply comes into being with the advent of tabloids or the internet or any other contemporary phenomenon. The Scarlet Letter, one of the most powerful and prescient stories of the private self and its exposure, locates the conflict between the need to conceal and the drive to unmask the self in Puritan New England. Ushered onto the scaffold for bearing a child adulterously, Hester Prynne is paraded, the embroidered scarlet A glaring from her chest before a baying crowd. And of course, Monica Lewinsky made a lot of, I think, quite astute play on the resonances of her own case with Hester Prynne's. The Beadle proclaims the righteous colony of Massachusetts where iniquity is dragged out into the sunshine. Holding her baby, the shaming evidence of this iniquity, Hester is forced to bear the heavy weight of 1,000 unrelenting eyes. But the glare of 1,000 eyes and of the sunshine itself fails to ensure the triumph of Boston's pious light over Hester's corrupted darkness. On the contrary, Hawthorne notes, in the face of her lush beauty, the world was only the darker. In the face of her lush beauty, the world was only the darker. Her inner self is rendered not less obscure by the drive to unmask it. For all the penetrative force of its 1,000 eyes, for all its concentrated focus on her heart, the crowd never gets to see what it's looking for. Just how far is the profane glare of today's TV cameras and telephoto lenses from the pious light of Hawthorne's Puritan crowd? Do they not share the same zeal to purge the self of its secrets, the same hatred of the self's dark recesses? Our culture, I'm suggesting, is as heavily policed as Puritan Boston's by Beadle's dragging our iniquity into the sunshine. Literature, as the example of Hawthorne suggests, allies itself with Hester over the Beadle, with the preservation of the essential ambiguity of the self over its enforced transparency. We turn to literature as an antidote to the quantification of the self, for a sense of inner life as in excess of any laws or metrics or principles under which it could be subsumed. It's this sense that I would argue that the defense of privacy is tied to the defense of imaginative life. At the end of 2014, an international group of writers drafted a petition decrying the escalation of state surveillance and calling for an international digital bill of rights. Now, why, we might ask, should writers have any more distinct contribution to make to this debate than, say, florists or basketball players? Well, in one sense, they don't. Insofar as privacy is an essential dimension of any and every human life to which no one has any more right than anyone else, certainly not by virtue of their profession. But if privacy has become such an urgently live issue for writers, it's because it's the air that the imagination breathes. At stake in the incursions of the state, the media and of corporations into our everyday lives is the right to an inner life as much as to the protection of our personal data. A self coerced into permanent visibility will come to feel constrained not only in what she can say, but eventually in what she can think and imagine. In externalizing the self, a surveillance society, not only the persecutory monitoring of the totalitarian state envisioned by Orwell, but the more tacitly imposed pseudo-benign mutual monitoring of our social media culture, threatens our interiority, our right to a private self that ensures we can never be fully transparent to others or to ourselves. I think this is probably why, as well as being rather malign, the mantra "nothing to hide, nothing to hear" simply makes no sense to me. The very meaning and richness of our lives depends on us having something to hide. In a culture that is driven to render us ever more transparent to one another, literature and art may be one of the few spaces in which to keep hold of this understanding of the private self. Without an implicit claim to privacy, to an external and internal room of one's own, there can be no literature. There can be, I think much more broadly, because I don't want to confine it to literature, there can be no creative life. From the earliest days of the psychoanalytic movement, literature and psychoanalysts have shared a mutual fascination and no doubt too mutual suspicion. But I see that mutual fascination as their shared sense of the essential privacy of the self. Each, that is, literature and psychoanalysis, strives for a deep knowledge of the self, but premises that striving for knowledge on a recognition of the limits of knowledge. What I can know about myself or anyone else is conditioned by what I cannot know. In the interpretation of dreams, Freud famously speaks of the navel of the dream, the spot where it reaches down into the unknown. It's the spot where the analyst, who seems to know everything, where his mastery runs aground, where she recognizes something in the dream that has, as he puts it, that has to be left obscure. Now, Freud's intuition of this spot of obscurity, I suggest, has a peculiar and urgent resonance at this juncture in history. In a culture of tacitly coerced visibility, which assigns meaning only to what can be seen and measured, how is this region of obscurity in our dreams and in our waking selves to be valued and protected? That's the question I'll leave you with. Thank you.
Okay, so we have just over 20 minutes for discussion. So I can see Alfred has a question there. So why don't we start? Do you want to go first, Alfred? Yeah. Mike's just coming.
Hi, thanks. Is this on? Yes. Yeah. I have a question for Barbara. I thought all the presentations were fascinating, but I was struck by what you said about Rousseau, which was about the idea that the democratic republic requires that, you know, that the kind of the non-public man is nothing. I thought it was very striking because I hadn't really thought about that before, but it put me in mind of Rousseau's absolute sort of deep hostility to faction and to the idea of association and any association that was not the entirety of the collective. And so I suppose my narrow question is like, how is the relation between solitude and association? How does that sort of play out in Rousseau? But it got me to thinking more broadly about the relationship between solitude and association, because I always think of solitude and association as having a different sort of relation, that solitude actually disables association. And so when you think about the history of the gay rights movement or something, the fact that everybody had this, you know, the fact that people would not be able to speak publicly or to act publicly meant that they were unable to know that they weren't alone, and they were unable to associate and to act together and share experiences and make claims for rights against the state or make claims. And that this story, and you can really take that as a sort of symbol of a larger group of movements, you label the personal as political, that used a kind of, that took this sort of view that solitude actually meant the entrenchment of existing power relations because people were unable to associate by sharing, which puts a very different valence on the sort of contemporary talk, some of the contemporary talk we're having. So that was my broader thought behind it. But basically the question is, what's the relationship between solitude and association, do you think?
Thank you for that point. And in a sense, I mean, you put it better than I did, so I don't really have much to add, in the sense that that was also the point that I was getting at the end of my talk as my sort of addendum, which is, and I think that we need to be we need to be cautious, don't we, in the way that we talk about questions of privacy and entitlements to privacy. Because, behind the story of Hester Prynne, for example, being exposed for her illicit sexual liaison is also the story of, as you say, of, lesbian women suppressing, being forced into closets like gay men, or questions of sexual abuse or whatever. So I think the whole question of what is designated as requiring privacy where does privacy, or whatever we might call it, solitude, become enforced on people? And at the same time, how is it then that the forms of exposure are voluntary? What is voluntary? And that seems to me to be terribly important. The whole question of Facebook or Snapchat or whatever is one of voluntary exposure, and then people discovering that those forms of exposure lead them into involuntary publicity. Maybe you and I could discuss Rousseau. I suspect that that's a conversation that might not interest other people as much as it might interest you and me.
Okay, we've got Anne Alexander at the back.
Thank you. And thank you to all the panelists for a very interesting and thoughtful presentation. My comment follows on, actually, from Alfred's about the question of agency in relation to the transition between public and private, because I study social movements, and a lot of the work that I do looks at social movements in authoritarian contexts, particularly in the Middle East. And it's very striking to me how the strategies of authoritarian states are very much based on this radical negation of the right to have not only the private life of democratic action, which is absolutely necessary to producing public forms of democratic action. You can't organize a protest or a collective letter signed by people or any form of public collective action in a country like Egypt, for example, without the right to be private and organize it outside of the glare of the state. And the state is always attempting to break that down. But they also attempt to intrude into people's personal lives, and to, there is a very common tactic by the secret police to take all sorts of details of people's individual private lives and use them against them if they are considered to be playing a role in trying to engender dissident public collective action. So I think that was the question of agency, I think, is really important. And just as a comment on the around the issue of Rousseau and the surveillance of the state, it's very interesting. Someone like David Cameron, who is not in favour of encryption, for example, is in favour of using the Panamanian firm that he did for the offshore trust. And if you look at the gathering of the rich and powerful of the world, from Putin to Cameron, across divides of authoritarian and democratic states, they assert their right to a kind of privacy which is denied to everyone else.
Anybody want to comment on any of that?
David? Say just a word? Thank you. I that's a very interesting point. And I think one of the things that it highlights is the relationship between different rights, different values. And if one's trying to articulate the particular interest that requires protection in different contexts. We see in a large number of judicial decisions from, for example, the European Court of Human Rights, a refusal to decide questions of, let's say, breach of the right to respect for private life in political contexts, because it said it adds nothing to the right to freedom of conscience, freedom of association, or freedom of expression. And there's a slight awkwardness that I feel, at least, in trying to use the idea of privacy to do a job in relation to activities which are simply not private. And they may be incidental too, but they are not private. And to say, it does tend to reduce the scope of the notion of privacy if one extends or tries to extend it in a way which takes it into the area of very unprivacy-like interests.
I'm not sure, but I think that one of the things that might be at stake for me here when you talk about authoritarian regimes and the stranglehold on privacy is that this isn't merely a kind of pragmatic dimension of politics. It's not simply an instrumental imperative to stop people having spaces where they can develop and cultivate their own thoughts and their own resistances and put them into practice. It's actually, I think, an attempt to produce a certain kind. I mean, this is why we come back to Orwell again and again. It's an attempt to produce a certain kind of psychic state in which not only is it pragmatically and externally not possible to perform the kinds of actions you would need to resist, but actually to have a state of mind in which you could resist, to close down the kind of breathing space internally in which it would make it possible to have a new or surprising or dangerous thought. And that's why, for me, there is a relationship between political privacy and imaginative privacy.
Can we bring the mic down to the front, the woman in yellow shirt just there?
Thank you. So my question is for David Feldman. You said that, of course, different legal systems have culturally specific definitions of what privacy is, but they're also operating against an international context. So we had last week the celebrity press injunction against the British press, but at the same time, anybody who wants to kind of read about that can look up a foreign media website and read freely. So you have this situation of kind of absurdity, really. And I just wondered how you think we can deal with that, or how that affects how we can think about privacy from a legal perspective.
My answer is that you can't. That's not actually the example of the injunction isn't an example particularly of different attitudes between jurisdictions, although they're are, of course, and you might get a very different answer from a US court from the one that you got from a UK or English court as to whether that injunction could properly be granted. But it's more a matter of practicality. Is there any point in having legal rules and trying to grant legal remedies in situations where we all know they're not going to be effective? Now, there are degrees of ineffectiveness, and it may well be that if we had, as the Attorney General has threatened, one or two people who have been spreading this foul stuff on the internet, or good stuff on the internet, depending on your point of view, dragged into court and sent down for contempt of court for breaching the injunction, that might set up a sort of in terrorem effect where other people would be less likely to do that, particularly if it were well publicised, probably through the internet. But we're talking here about whether law can have a direct enforcement effect. Answer, probably no. Can it have a deterrent effect? Well, that all depends on what you do to try to enforce it and how well it's publicized and so on and so forth. But those are questions of social concern, but I don't think that it's anything that the legal system can actually do anything about.
John, can you shout? Or?
Yeah. I've got a question for each of the, or a comment for each of the panelists. For Professor Feldman, I liked and appreciated your attempt to corral this fuzzy subject into something that lawyers can address. But in terms of the conception of using the coercive power of the state in a privacy-related area, there is one strange anomaly we have now, which is that it is the state which is itself eroding the privacy of its citizens. And we appear not to have a working method of applying the rule of law to that. For Barbara, I was struck by the fact that she, as far as I know, did not make any mention of solitary confinement as a cruel and unusual punishment.
Wrong period.
No, that's a beautiful historian's answer. Thank you. And for Josh said at one point that the William Hague mantra, so to speak, about if you have nothing to hide, then you have no fear and all this, it makes no sense to him. Well, it doesn't make any sense to me either. Well, why in the name of God, then, are so many people accepting it?
Shall I? Do you want to go first?
Okay.
I'll answer the mic.
I think that they're accepting a lot more than the mantra. I think they're accepting the terms of a culture in which you are reducible to what you don't hide, right? To one's external manifestations, and I think if you, I mean, this is where I think the dimensions of imagination and selfhood really start to intrude into the whole debate, because in a way implicit in the mantra is a certain conception of selfhood. The self that hides and that wants to conceal things is really written out of that formula. It isn't allowed to exist except in the kind of McMullen mode of a kind of nefarious, insidious actor that wants to do bad things. So the existence, if you like, of a sort of, you know, a positive and necessary dimension of a hidden self, I think the first thing you have to do is do away with that. And then you'll get people to accept the equation that something something to hide is something to be feared.
Can I then come back to the point about the coercive power of the state, when it's the state that's exercising coercive power to interfere with privacy? I simply, looking at it historically, don't recognize that as a description of what's going on. It's quite a popular misconception that that's what's going on, but I don't recognize it. If you go back beyond 1985, we had a situation where the state, simply on by an authorization given by the Home Secretary, or in foreign relations issues, the Foreign Secretary, could order officials without any sort of form of legal review or accountability to open all letters, to intercept communications of any kind, telephonic or written, although this was less clear, to enter premises and, Peter Wright famously wrote, bug and burgle their way around London, especially the embassies of London. And there was no legal redress for that, whatever, unless they happened to be caught committing a trespass to property. go back further, and we have lettres de cachet in the 16th century. The Tudor governments were very good at seizing people and letters, and quite a lot of interesting historical documents have been private documents have been preserved in the National Archives simply because the government made a practice of doing that against political opponents and others. So what's actually happened since 1985 in this country, and in slightly different ways since 1953 among member states of the Council of Europe through the operation of the European Convention on Human Rights, is that those state prerogatives, as they've been regarded, have been progressively brought under legal control. So we've had from 1985 in this country interception of communications having to be authorised by reference to fairly loose legal requirements, and those were tightened up progressively over the following 15 years ago or so. Since 2000, when the Human Rights Act came into force, there's been an enforceable right to respect for correspondence under Article 8. And the government then has, if it interferes with correspondence, has to justify that by reference to the criteria of Article 8 too. So what has actually been going on is a progressive process of bringing the use of state power for these purposes within legal and related administrative controls. And the question really is, should that continue to happen? And it's happened because the government has voluntarily submitted itself to those regimes. It's the government and parliament that have authorized the use of state power against the state. It's a voluntary thing, and it can only be a voluntary thing, but we're much better off now than we were before 1985.
Okay, there are a couple of lawyers queuing up, so I'm just wondering. I'm just wondering whether we should. So, can you try and be succinct because we're getting short on time, and Christina wants to come back. So, David, do you want to go first as you were in the queue, and then
do my best. Mainly a question for Josh. You say privacy is the air that imagination breathes, and obviously there's a sense that that's true. I mean, in legal terms, you think of David Richards' work actually in America looking at that aspect. But artistic and literary work is often very intrusive and investigatory. I mean, that's, you know, you think of the artworks which flash and try and catch people unawares, but there's just generally it's very investigatory and intrusive, which I think links to sort of Aristotle's notion that humans are social and political beings. Of course, if you want an imaginative experience, you need to engage often with the world. And I suppose that leads to paradoxes. And it seems to me that if we're going to look at this in the round, and of course, literary and artistic expression does have huge carve-outs from privacy law and personal information law, we need to recognise, and in a way this is David's point, sort of the context and the need for balances of other values against privacy. And in fact, artistic and literary work is a perfect example of the need for those kind of balances, as in fact is national security as well, as far as I can see. But just a thought, and maybe for a comment back.
Yes, I'm actually not wanting to invoke the defence of privacy in opposition to the claims of security or social and political life at all. I think what I'm saying is that we impoverish social and political life when we impoverish the scope of our privacy. And I think it's in that sense that I was thinking about the sort of the exemplary case of art and literature. In a way, the philosophical source for this thought, although I have my disagreements with her on this point, is Hannah Arendt, who, of course, is in a way one of the most fierce defenders of the human being as a social and well as a political animal, and of the importance of thinking about human life as the preservation of public space and of political space. But her point is that if we're going to preserve what she thinks of as an authentically political space, then there has to be an inviolable private realm, a realm of what she calls darkness, that we don't shine light into, that political life is really the possibility of emerging from this darkness into the light. So I think of public and private not in terms of an opposition where we are constantly sort of making claims for one at the expense of the other, more in terms of a kind of intimacy, where one conditions the other and one makes the other possible.
Okay, so Christina, let's go back to the queue. Can someone just... Thanks, Judith.
You get the Vanna White Award for the microphone here. I actually also, I'm going to follow up on John and have three comments / questions. And first of all, a thank you to this panel for lots of notes that I took. I'm very, very interested in everything that you had to say. Maybe I'll go backwards. That might be the easiest way to do this. So, Josh, I just want to underscore everything that you said and maybe offer up just a tiny little bit of evidence from my own work. In the defense of privacy is the defense of imaginative life, which is a lovely turn of phrase, and that the meaning and the richness of our lives depends on us having something to hide. You know, in terms of secrets and all of the negativity that seems to be associated with them, one of the sweetest that I heard during my interviews came from a 68-year-old man who had his deepest, darkest secret that he wanted to share with me that nobody else knew. And it was that he still dreamed of being a rock star. And he would go down into his basement and put his amplifier very low so that nobody could hear, you know. And it was this thing that he treasured above all others and I think was really central to who he was. I would also say that you had this phrase, what I can know of anyone is limited by what I cannot. And I heard another great story from a woman who went to her high school reunion, her 30th high school reunion, and she was not on Facebook, but everybody else at the high school reunion was. And she had the most wonderful time while she was there. Because nobody knew what was going on. They all wanted to catch up, and everybody else was bored out of their minds because they knew it all. For Barbara, I couldn't agree more with so much of what you said. And I think, you know, Evyatar Zerubbabel wrote a book a couple of years ago called The Elephant in the Room on the sociology of silence, denial, and inattention, which really gets at the politics behind the things that we refuse to let people to talk about. And I think the creativity of individuals in finding ways to talk about those things or bear some very serious consequences. You know, I talked to people for whom the fact that they were gay was their calling card. It was the first thing they wanted you to know about them. And I talked to people for, if you ever found that out about them, they didn't know what they would do. They might simply end their life. It was such a horrible thing for them. So to find these other ways in which people can be, this lovely phrase you had, the right to be public but heard with respect. That's just beautiful. I think it's a lovely, and I can't wait to read all about solitude and solitary life. David, my question for you, in the interests of contributing to the continuous contestation of law, you said that the rights and obligations that protect that privacy, right, is the rights and obligations that protect physical spaces and times and relationships as necessary for people to contribute to positive social activity. And I would love to hear you define positive social and activity. Thank you.
So as we're encroaching on lunch break, as you were directly invited, do you want to come back if you can, and then we might have to wrap up there?
I don't know whether I can do it, but I've tried to do it, and probably the easiest way is if I send you a link to the papers in which I've done it. Thank you.
Okay, so that's online, offline. Okay, on that note, let's thank our speakers and go for lunch.